name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. This Life Sunday, as we take some time out of the year to meditate on the gift of life and the dignity of human life in particular, I'd like to remind you of those words we heard on Christmas Day. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and the Word became flesh. This is a miracle that we know, which we perceive by faith, but we cannot fully grasp. We read in Holy Scripture how even the angels in heaven marvel at the miracle of the Incarnation. It is a miracle far beyond the understanding even of the heavenly hosts. Jesus is the Word of God. Jesus is God. And herein lies the dignity of man. Not simply that we are created by God and given the gift of life. Not simply that we are created in the image of God originally, but that eternal, almighty, infinite, and everlasting God was incarnate to stand among us in his own human flesh. The one who created time put himself in that time, in history, in a place for the life of us, his children. And dearly beloved, what infinite God has assumed, what immortal God has taken upon himself, what almighty God has redeemed is of infinite value. And what did he assume? What did he take upon himself? He entered the world the same way that you did. He came as an infinitesimally small cell, the fullness of infinite God, and man at his most finite, all in one divinely fertilized egg. Behold the Virgin. God has come out from heavenly light, from behind the heavenly temple veil, and yet you still cannot see him. The light has entered the darkness, but he remains hidden for a time, for 9 months, behind the veil of Mary's flesh. The child not yet born, but already called holy, Son of the Most High, Son of God. No one could see him, but God was in his temple, dwelling with his people. This is the great mystery of our Christian faith. God at work, but hidden. You cannot see him within his mother. Does that which resides in a mother's belly lack dignity because we cannot see it? Because it is so small? Dearly beloved, what God has assumed is of infinite value. God was found in the appearance as a man, taking the form of a servant, as the Apostle Paul says, and it begins in the Virgin's womb. In order to defeat sin, death, and the devil, that unholy Trinity to which man is bound because of our weakness, God takes upon himself weakness. This is the Lord of the universe in weakness. An embryo so fragile, mighty God, guarded by nothing stronger than the flesh of Mary's womb. Hidden in the darkness, but coming to bring light. Let's not move past this too fast. Jesus, true God, begotten from eternity, once a zygote himself, and then later in the wonder of life and human birth, born of the Virgin Mary. The eternal, omnipotent Son from heaven, an embryo cared for in the mercy of his mother's womb. We've become accustomed to the strange sound but biblical truth of sayings like, God sat on Mary's lap. God ate and drank with his friends. God died. The one who created the heavens and the earth became flesh, blood, and bone like us. You just have to look at any newborn baby to get a sense of what your God was like and what he had become to save us. The one who has no beginning, sent by the Father, knit together by the Holy Spirit in the dark protection of Mary's womb, born of his virgin mother. A God who comes weak, little baby weak, precisely to bring about salvation. This is how our God works. He has begun this marvelous thing. Now we move ahead 3 decades later As we heard last week, his cousin John is publicly proclaiming Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. John preaches and points to the grown-up Jesus. Although John had already worshipped Jesus once before from the womb of his own mother, when he was filled with the Holy Spirit, that was the same John, that yet unborn baby boy, leaping for joy in the presence of his Creator God. 30 years later, at the river, John is still worshiping Jesus. There is Jesus, there goes God into the River Jordan, where John's message has been, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." And the Father proclaims, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased." And the heavens opened up, and the Holy Spirit descends like a dove. But don't miss the fact that it is God himself standing in the water, standing where we sinners stand, looking just like us. And then the Spirit leads Jesus out into the desert to do what? To battle the devil for 40 days. And there we see Jesus, true man, the second and greatest Adam of all, saying, "Away from me, Satan, and even the devil must obey." All this brings us to this Epiphany season, to this day. John the Baptist is now in prison for his preaching. It will get worse for him, as we heard recently. He will be beheaded, because the world which sits in darkness is opposed to this life-giving word of God. And yet, the word cannot be stopped. John is arrested, but now his message is on Jesus' own lips. "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." Jesus has begun to fulfill the words of Isaiah prophesied long ago in centuries past. So having remembered the miracle of the incarnation this morning, we know what is really happening in today's text. That it is Jesus, it is God who is traveling through Galilee. It is God who is leaving Nazareth, God who lives in Capernaum, the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, the way of the sea beyond the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. Such mundane, faraway locations, land, sea, Jordan, Zebulun, Naphtali, all so ordinary when Isaiah first spoke of them hundreds of years before, and just as ordinary sounding to us today as we hear Matthew's gospel recounting Jesus' travels. But these mundane earthly places are places that God himself visited. God takes such deep interest in places we find boring and insignificant. First the womb, then the manger, then the Jordan, Zebulun, Naphtali, and now here. This pulpit from which he speaks to you, and this altar from which he feeds you, bringing the kingdom of heaven near. It is at hand because the kingdom of heaven is wherever Jesus the King is. The one who is incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary then is still and forever incarnate. Word incarnate, body incarnate, blood incarnate. Seated at the right hand of the Father and also seated upon this altar for you, for the forgiveness of your sins. This place, Zion, Evangelical Lutheran Church, has much in common with those ancient lands, which is why Jesus comes to us, because of the darkness. Or what God calls darkness, and what God calls a thing is what it really is. Matthew and Isaiah both say it, and you hear it this morning. People sitting, just sitting in darkness, suffering in darkness, crying in darkness, mourning in darkness. Indeed, we are only separated from Zebulun and Naphtali by incidental things like time and geography, yet in all the ways that count, we are very much like them. They are living in the land of the shadow of death, which is to say that they are sitting where death has been and always will come again. Death in your ailing bodies, death around you, plenty of funerals. Death is at work all around us, as witnessed by the cemetery across the street. Each grave marked by a marker, identifying the person lying there, a commemoration to them from those who loved them during their earthly life. And hopefully, even a scripture verse, inscribed in the stone that confesses them as one who is loved still by the Father and lives still with the Father in heaven with Christ. But death is at work in the shadows as well. As you drive by the Planned Parenthood clinic in Fort Wayne, behind nondescript walls in a sterile room, death is at work. Doctors ply their trade to kill. Death not marked, death not mourned, death not seen as a tragedy, but as a triumph of self-actualization, of women's liberation. The Lord Jesus tells us to judge a tree by its fruit. What are the fruits of this ideology? Some 60 million dead. Indeed, we sit in darkness and death is at work. We hear the mantra, "My body, my choice," echoing throughout the land. It is a demonic inversion of the Lord's own words. "Take, eat, this is my body given for you for the forgiveness of sins." And there is something we must remember, dearly beloved. We are not our own. It is not her body, it is not your body, it is not my body. But after the cross of Christ, who died for all bodies are bought by Jesus, redeemed by Jesus. You and every child conceived in the foreknowledge of God, before the foundation of the world, bought with blood, not with gold or silver, not with money, but by the blood of God, which means the bodies of mothers and fathers, the bodies of the child yet unborn in the womb, whether we can see him or her or not, has infinite value. It has the value of the very blood of God. But still, this is a sinful age, and so still we sit in darkness. It could be that long silent darkness of a pressured mother weeping because her child never had a birthday, and she wishes it had been not that way. And pressure from a husband or parents, or particularly from a boyfriend, is one of the most common reasons for an abortion. Or it could be the darkness of the young man who looks back and cries because he will always be a father to a child who will not sit at his table, whom he did not protect and whom he did not provide for. The darkness of looking back on a time when darkness and death seemed like a good alternative for a difficult situation, a quick treatment for an unfortunate or unplanned pregnancy that only God saw and found fortunate. Your wife, your daughter, your relatives, Christians indeed, have abortions. In a country and a culture where the lie is so powerful, many find abortion, find darkness an appealing idol, and death a helpful cure. But how does that person, how do you, how do I get out of that darkness? We don't. We can't. We can't claw our way out of the darkness. There is only the light that breaks in from outside, outside of us, outside of this world. The light that dawns, fulfilling exactly what the prophet Isaiah prophesies. Jesus is the only light for our darkness, and he brings with him mercy. It is easy for us Christians to say that God, that Jesus died for the sins of the whole world. But when it comes to those certain sins, whatever we have in the dark from our past, we torment ourselves as if that is certainly the only sin that Jesus won't forgive or can't forgive. My abortion, my acquiescence to an abortion, my adultery, my silence, my lies, or whatever that evil day was or is. But God will have none of that. He says this, "The people who walked in darkness see a great light. Those who dwelt in the shadow of the land of death, upon them a light has shined." Isaiah can't say enough about it. This bright light who shatters the darkness, it is Jesus, God incarnate, forgiveness, salvation, my sin undone. Yes, the people dwelling in darkness have seen a great light. And for those dwelling in the region and shadow of death, on them a light has dawned. Dearly beloved, the light has dawned on us. This Jesus, God's Son, has been given to fight your enemies for you. All sin and death and the accusing power of the law were instead placed upon Jesus, and they did their best on him. And in putting Christ to death on the cross, they defeated themselves. They put themselves to death. It is the foolishness of God, the weakness of man, the weakness of the man Jesus dying for us. It is like the foolishness on the day of Midian, with Gideon's foolish jars and torches. It appears foolish, a God so weak, a fetus in the womb, a child, and then a man crucified. But God's foolishness, his way, is true wisdom after all. Because your sin is paid for by Jesus' dying. Your death is undone by that dying for you. And death has been swallowed up altogether by Jesus' rising. The darkness is vanquished and the light shines from the fonts, from the altars, and from the pulpits, with the blood and water springing forth from the punctured side of Jesus' own human body. Where there was darkness, sin, and death, now resides light, forgiveness, and life. Light, forgiveness, and life of those who are guilty of committing an abortion. And hope for the victims too. For what Christ has assumed, he has redeemed. And what he has taken upon himself is of infinite value to the Father. And he himself, the Word incarnate, was a zygote, a blastocyst, a fetus, a baby born in the womb. Truly, Mary's body does not belong to her after all. Her womb and every mother's womb is the workshop of the Holy Spirit, where he knits you together, a body, to live with God the Father forever. No one's body belongs to themselves. You are not your own. For each of you has received your body and your own self as a gift from God your Creator. And each of you has been purchased by the blood of Christ our Redeemer. And what a marvelous work it is that he does. Jesus, the light of the world. Amen. May rise for the collection.